Basically, you know, I learned everything I know about atrial fibrillation surgery from Jim Cox, who taught me two things. One is to stick to the basics, and the other thing, not to be dogmatic. Unfortunately, with AFib, you probably have to be dogmatic in order to be successful over time. And the reason I went to do AFib surgery as a young surgeon straight from residency is because I wanted to do mitral valve surgery, and I figured out this would be the only way I can get mitral valve patients if I can offer them fix for the atrial fibrillation. And I was right, but I didn't really believe that 20 years later almost, the question would be whether you should ablate or not. It, for me, 20 years ago when I went to this, I knew that they should be ablated. But so that's an interesting, it's the interesting way how it comes about. So should we ablate? Well, what do we know in 2018? It is an open field with many, many opinions, and as you'll see later, not too much of training and really experience in many, many places in the world, and including the U.S. And basically, I believe that yes, when indicated and safe. And I think safe is really important. And for me, patients coming from mitral valve surgery or concomitant procedures other than mitral valve surgery that have pulmonary hypertension, that have poor RV function, and so on and so forth, I'll be very, very careful to add anything to their procedure. But I'll always at least leave the operating room with the control of their left atrial appendage. So something needs to be done. But you need to use judgment. And in my own numbers, when you look, and we publish quite a bit about it, my own numbers for the decision making, 92% of my patients coming to mitral valve procedure are having AFib surgery, not 100%. So not all of them, if you feel it's unsafe, and safety and judgment is something you go with, and experience is definitely part of what we are all going through. As we age and being more experienced surgeons. But what do we know? So I will talk about the guidelines tomorrow. I don't want to talk too much about it, but there is some evidence from the guidelines, basically, and recommendation from the STS. I will talk about the European ones and the AGRS tomorrow. But surgical ablation for AF can be performed without additional risk of operative mortality or major morbidity, and is recommended at the time of concomitant mitral valve surgery to restore sinus rhythm. So it's a one level A. So we have a lot of evidence that it is important and it is working. The Richard Clark Award from last year was given to Scott Rankin that basically showed that performing surgical ablation at the time of mitral valve disease is actually associated with lower operative mortality, and that's also very, very important. Dr. Svensson, who sits here, put together some recommendation for guidelines from the AATS, which I was privileged to head, as well as the STS ones. And we took a different approach to it, looking into the evidence with multiple meta-analysis and by single questions that were answered one at a time. This is an international group with European surgeons as well, and Asian, not just American. And what we found is basically that additional of concomitant ablation is associated with improvement of operative mortality or survival at 30 days, class one level A evidence. So basically, what I want to tell you is that if you decide to do surgical ablation, and let alone, I didn't mention which one yet, you are not increasing the risk of the patient. You're probably improving the chances of the patient to come out of surgery better, including 30 days survival. So that's a big misconception that I think the level, and you'll see it also in the AGRS guideline, and to some extent Manuel already shared it for the European guidelines, you see that this is really important point. But the question is, why should we ablate? And I will try to answer earlier. This is our forest plot to show it. It's clearly showing that basically it's improving 30 days survival and also long-term survival. These are two slides, this one and the next one, that I borrowed from my good friend Mark Gilinov after one of his talks. And he basically showed that in the Cleveland Clinic experience, it is associated with decreased risk of stroke and decreased risk of mortality when you treat atrial fibrillation following mitral valve. I added also decreased quality of life. And this is the famous slide that he used to use in the past based on all the data from the Cleveland Clinic showing that if you leave them, patients following mitral valve surgery without AF are doing much better than patients doing that are with AF. So AF is not only a prognostic entity, I say, it's also a surrogate for more complex patients. We know that patients with AF coming to mitral valve surgery are not necessarily sharing the same risk that patients that are in sinus rhythm. And we looked at it as well from our perspective, and this is one of our publications on the issue. We looked at mitral valve, tricuspid valve, AF, no AF, and also mitral valve only. And as you can see, if you treat the patients with a MACE procedure, as opposed to leaving them alone, you see that there is a significant difference in their survival in the follow-up. And basically, it's kind of a reverse one. The patient that had the MACE procedure even had a better prognosis. The patient that came, that were in sinus rhythm without anything, that came into surgery with sinus rhythm. But nevertheless, this is not statistically significant. And you can clearly see that by performing surgical ablation, you're probably going to restore the survival of those patients moving forward. Here is the same example of patients following mitral valve only, same survival if they came in sinus rhythm or had surgical ablation as opposed to be left alone. However, you have to look to, you have to read the paper to look at this very strong propensity match of about 300 pairs to show that we didn't just look at the unadjusted, also we looked also at the adjusted risk factors, because the patients with AF are basically a sicker patient. And therefore, the comparison to AF versus surgical AF is very, very important with risk adjusted, as I mentioned. And it showed the same. If you do risk adjusted survival, you have the same same mortality difference for those two subgroup of patients, and leaving them alone is hurting them. And very low embolic stroke rate. And these are the results. As you know, we have a very strong database. We are collecting 3,000 variables per patient, following them very strictly. And you can expect around 80% success rate off medication and about close to 90% on medication if you do a MACE procedure on mitral valve patients moving forward. But what does it mean, and the title of the debate was in atrial fibrillation, should we treat patients in atrial fibrillation? Because we, as Patrick said, some patients are coming with single entity of atrial fibrillation in their history, and as you know, single entity of atrial fibrillation in the history of a mitral valve patient move them immediately to a 2A indication for repair if you're going to an experienced surgeon, and thank God for that, because we see many, many more patients earlier on the mitral valve disease process. So those patients with giant left atria and long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation in the mitral valve prolapse group, at least, is diminishing all the time. However, it's a very important question. What about new onset, less than 3 months? What about left atrial size? Should we combine the two? And the answer is probably yes. There is a very famous paper by Obadiah from quite a few years ago who looked at a problem and look, if you had a very short duration of atrial fibrillation and you do nothing following mitral valve repair, you should expect about 85% success rate or freedom from atrial fibrillation when you follow the patients for a year. So that's excellent MACE procedure. So there is something in it that we don't quite understand yet, and probably very early AF should be either treated very minimally or should be treated or should not be treated at all, but I don't have the answer. We did publish a paper on left atrial only. And we show that if you don't have older age, non-paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, okay, left atrial size is less than 5.5, and duration is less than 5 years, and you do only left-sided procedure, you should expect about 92% success rate off medication at 1 and 2 years. However, if you have one of them, it drops significantly. If you have two, it drops even more significantly, to about 65 to 70%. It was published in the Annals last year. So I think it's a partial answer. But even Ubadia showed that if you have AFib versus not, your prognosis is much less good. Hartzell Schaff and his group did look in the question of new onset atrial fibrillation as well, and they did publish a paper almost like the Ubadia paper in the past, but recently they published two more papers. This is one of them, and they even looked into a prophylactic MACE procedure. And their answer is basically kind of gray, but they showed that atrial fibrillation down the road is associated with tricuspid insufficiency and lower survival. And therefore, they recommend in patients in higher risk of developing atrial fibrillation down the road, i.e. mainly very large left atrium at the time of mitral valve surgery, even in sinus rhythm, you should go and ablate them prophylactically. I think it's a stretch. What we do with patients with, let's say, 6 centimeter atrium in sinus rhythm, we take them to the EP lab and we try to induce atrial fibrillation. If it's easily induced, then we know that there is something in there. But mind you, the guidelines, as I will talk about tomorrow, are very critical about symptomatic atrial fibrillation versus not when you come and treat the patient. So I think this is still an open question. Who should be the ablator? For the first time in this consensus statement for the AATS, we really came with a strong recommendation about it, saying that basically surgical ablation procedures should require basic training, proctoring, and education. This day, the majority of atrial fibrillation procedures being done worldwide are done by surgeons that were never had official training. Nothing that can be said about aortic surgery, CABG, mitral valve surgery, and so on and so forth. All you need right now is to go to have a dinner with a sales rep who show you a sketch of the lesions, and then you go and the next day you ablate. So the results are basically the same. And I think that the most important slide in the world of AFib surgery, I don't have it here today because it's a proprietary of Medtronic, is the results of the CURE-AF trial. This is a trial that failed in 2007-2008 where they tried to get indication for their device. Same device, same lesion set, 15 centers, success rate at 1 year between 0% and 100%. Basically, it's not the device fault, it's the surgeon fault. So there is no training, and the first time we took a bite at it is basically in the AATS guidelines that we say, no, you need to train those surgeons. Surgeon needs to go through something, but this is just the beginning. We need to do much more about it. Which energy source? Well, surgical ablation is affected by energy source. And in general, I think that doing everything with cryo is superior to cryo and bipolar RF. Although if you look at the AATS guidelines, I'll talk about it tomorrow, RF should be associated with good transmurality. Cryo is more significant. We published it in cryo only at 6 years, showing 83% success rate of medication as opposed to 72%. We can also see that the cryo versus combination of energy sources has some significant differences when it comes to left atrial size, but basically this paper looked into size of the atrium, as size of the atrium and how to move about with it, and also about energy sources. So the good news, if you take 5.5 or larger versus 5.5 or smaller, embolic stroke is the same following as a successful surgical ablation. Success rate is also, the probability of success over time is somewhat different as the size of the atrium is here as and the probability of success is on the y-axis. And as you can see, if you take a 6 centimeter, the probability of success without medication, which is the non-dotted line, is fairly high. It's about, 90% at 1 year. So still, if you do an appropriate MACE procedure, you can get very good results even in a 6 centimeter one. If you want off medication, it's about 80% success at 1 year. And if you take an 8-centimeter one, you still have very high success over time. So the size itself is not really an issue of whether you should do it or not. It's what you do and how you modify a larger size atria. Thank God we don't have those much at all lately because of earlier referral. What about the duration of atrial fibrillation and success rate? I think this is the most significant predictor of failure. The longer the duration, the more remodeling you have, the more extensive and complex disease you have, and this is why definitely the only thing that if we will work and help the patient, that can work and help the patient is a full MACE procedure. This is just to show you that the duration less than 5 years or over 5 years has some impact with the energy sources, as you can see here. Cryo versus bipolar cryo, better success rate, statistically significant if you look at the type of duration. If you do cryo only, it doesn't matter how long the duration is. If you do RF only with cryo, then there is some significant impact on duration with the combined energy sources. There is more we can talk about. I think it's very important, but when you have advanced AF, large atrium and longer duration of AF, the better you do much better to the patients if you use cryo only. And we can talk about it. Right now in the US, we are about to embark a cryo only study with multiple centers, with leading centers, including Cleveland Clinic as part of them. And I think we'll show some results that were never showed before in a multi-center study. Again, effect of duration on combination energy versus not. As you can see here, the success rate is dropping with the combination energy when you follow the patient longer. So the conclusion, patients with mitral valve disease and AF should be ablated. However, surgeons should know how to ablate. That's the key. Surgeons should be familiar with the energy sources and how they work. Surgeons should be familiar with the key variable and the different arguments, because you can't be led by your electrophysiologist or cardiologist for that. You need to own your stuff and you have to know what to do with it. And do me a favor, don't call it a maze unless it is a maze, because that's where it all starts, all the confusion. Thank you.